Mr. Simon Maxwell, which of the 17 sustainable development goals or targets in particular are feasible in your opinion within the proposed deadlines for each, by case?
Well, you know, the question of whether we can eliminate poverty completely, give everybody a good education, solve all the health problems, including infectious diseases, and have peace, and have security, and cure the environment, this is a lot to ask. And I think it's very unlikely that we will achieve absolutely everything by 2030. We're not going to create paradise on Earth in only 15 years. But to have ambitious targets will focus minds. Now, the arrangement in the document and in the proposal that will be adopted in New York in September is that these are going to be global goals, and every country will then set its own goals. And of course, that will not just apply to developing countries, though this is not just for Ethiopia and Kenya and Colombia, it's also for Romania and all the other countries of the European Union to set their own goals. And it's certainly true in my country that we have work to do if we're going to achieve those goals. And I'm sure it must be true in every country that inequality and exclusion, for example, will have to be on the agenda of policymakers.
But for which of these do you think we are the most close to achieve?
Well, what is remarkable, and Ban Ki-moon said this in his introduction to the latest review of progress against the last generation of goals, the Millennium Development Goals, that this has been the fastest reduction in poverty in human history. And it is extraordinary to see the way in which we had a goal, which was to halve poverty compared to 1990 by 2015, and we have more than done it. Of course, not everywhere, and not for everybody. And one of the themes of the new generation will be leave no one behind. But if you look at progress on education and health, infectious diseases and poverty reduction, the world is a much better place now than it was in 2000 when the last goals were agreed.
What about the European Union policies? Which do you think should be the direction, the general direction, the priorities for the short term, let's say, on the next 1 or 2 years?
Well, what's interesting about Europe is that we have a budget cycle, which is a 7-year cycle, which is not quite the same as the political cycle, which is a 5-year cycle. So we have a document, an agreement called the Multiannual Financial Perspectives, which runs to 2020. So we know how much money we're going to be providing, and that is around 14, 15 billion euros every single year in development, which sounds a lot, and it is a lot of money, and we can do very good things with it. It's not enough. It should have been more. And when we look at the contributions that the European countries are making, they fall a long way behind the promises they made. You know, we promised in writing that the European countries, the older member states, would reach 0.7% of their gross national income by 2015, and the newer member states, of which Romania is one, would reach 0.33%. Only 2 or 3 countries have reached 0.7, and collectively, adding it all up, we are 38 billion euros a year behind where we said we would be, which sounds a lot of money, and it is, but of course, compared to the huge amounts of money that are needed to deal with the big financial crises, it's not so much. So we could do it, and we will need to do it, because apart from all the development problems that we still have to solve, we also have the big issue of climate change, which is going to need a great deal of money for investment in renewable energy, for example.
One question about the actual context regarding Greece. Could Greece step into the category of the countries that will need financial humanitarian assistance or financial aid in the context of international development cooperation policy?
Well, look, however the Greek crisis is resolved, there are going to be large numbers of people in Greece who are in need of social protection and social security in one way or another. And I'm sure that Europe as an institution and European countries will want to do everything they can to help. But we've been in this position before within our own countries. And what's absolutely clear is that we must never solve our own domestic problems in Europe by taking support resources away from the very poorest people in the world. We can't say to a mother who is at risk of dying in childbirth in Sierra Leone or in Kenya that we are going to stop funding the health services in her country because we have to help people in Greece. This is an additional problem. It's not a substitute. And as David Cameron, our Prime Minister, has said, we are not going to solve our problems on the backs of the poor. And surely that's a philosophy that we must all adopt in Europe. Of course we must solve our problems, of course we must. But we're not going to do it by making poverty worse in the poorest countries in the world.
So it would be a solution, but only if it doesn't affect the amount allocated to the poorest countries.
And, you know, there are still many hundreds of millions of people, over 1,000 million, living on less than $1 a day. 40% of all the children who die in the world die because or associated with malnutrition, because they're simply not getting enough to eat or are not healthy enough to use the food they have. There are still hundreds of thousands dying of malaria, women dying in childbirth. Those must be the priority for our development program. But do we say that because we help those people, we refuse to help our neighbours? Of course we don't. We are a community in Europe. We must stand as a community and we must work together.